Hooray! I just finished voting. Woohoo! That's it. That's the finger of democracy there going across your screen. So I've heard a rumor that me and the cat, we heard a rumor that this ink can be taken off. So I'm about to try and see if I could take it off of my friend Uncle Marvex, some bleach. That's the most popular thing I've heard people talk about. So let's see how much I got both of my fingers bleached. Not bleached, I got two of my fingers inked today on purpose so I could come and try it. I want one finger to prove I voted and, you know, to keep this around with me to remind me that I exercise my franchise. And I want the other finger, I dyed this so I could specifically come home and try and get it off to show you guys at home whether or not it's possible. So I'm going to try my best here. Let's have a go. I don't have any hydrogen peroxide, but let's try it with the bleach and see what happens. Okay, and there you go. That's after the first scrub alone. You can see a massive difference between those two fingers already. I imagine if I just put a bit more bleach on this, it won't be a problem to get it off. I'd probably have to clip that nail, which now looks very dirty with the blue under it. But you can see most of that indelible ink is already off of my finger. Look, take a look at the contrast there. That's with the first round of scrubbing. Let's see how much more bleach we have left in there. I don't want to damage my finger, but because I'm not desperate to vote twice, and I'm not intending to vote twice. This is just to test the claim.
There we go.
So there we go, I've run out of bleach, but that's the first test, right? That's how both my fingers looked when I got back from the polling station. After some bleach, one round of bleach and some scrubbing, that's how my little finger looks. There's a little hint of purple on the other side, but I'm wondering what a little more bleach might do to that. But I'm pretty surprised, even the little bit I had on my finger there. No, I don't think it's clean enough to allow me to go vote a second time if I had such horrible intentions. Plus there's the identity check part of the whole procedure. But nobody checked my finger for electoral ink at my polling station today. They didn't take my finger and look and see if I'd voted before. Maybe they observed my hands as I walked in, but I did expect that. So have a look for yourself and see what you come up with at home. Maybe someone might want to try some hydrogen peroxide. This thing here, this solution, I believe is silver nitrate. But have a go and see what you come up with at home, what results you get. All right, here we are again. This is about half an hour later. And now look at the contrast between the fingers. Yeah, even the cat is objecting. All right, let me take you outside so you can see this against a white wall.
Right, and this is what it looks like against a white wall. I've taken the nail off now with a little toothbrush. I could get in there and get that bit of bleach off. Get that bit of ink off, rather. Because I haven't really spent a lot of time on the tips. But you can see for yourself, most of the ink is gone. This is a couple hours after I voted. I wouldn't be so worried, except nobody checked my finger for ink in this polling station, as I said earlier. But there was a bit of breeze, I think. But no one checked my fingers for ink at my polling station. And I could very easily replicate the results on this finger, on this finger. There is the identity check, which is part of the fail-safe to prevent people voting twice. But this ink is a very important part of that that safeguarding procedure to make sure people only vote once. So I'm very shocked that this is how my finger would look after only an hour and a half or 2 hours, you know, after voting. So over to you.
So we've heard from, I've heard a few rumors. I think there's a lack of clarity on how indelible the indelible ink actually is. I've just last week in discussion with some young people telling them the ink cannot be removed. And I was told that some people have dipped their finger in Vaseline or some sort of lubricant. If you were to do this beforehand, dip your finger in lubricant and then you go dip it in the ink, and then very quickly when you go outside, you were able to wipe it off, then you would be able to erase effectively any trace that you'd voted. And this is behind the rumors of people being able to vote twice or multiple times.
But in order to do that, sir, mm-hmm. you would have to be registered twice. Right? After he has voted here, at this place, he's going to vote at another place. That means he's on another list. It's somewhere else. What you recall that we have this fingerprint cross-matching system. So he goes there. I mean, he's treading on real thin ice there. Right? But let me go back to your ink. The recommended level concentration of the chemical, which is silver nitrate, mm-hmm. which is supposed to be, is 15% globally. It was a 2006 election, and we took it, and one of the commissioners came running up and said, "Chief, look, I get this thing off." Right? Before I go there, let me tell you the Vaseline story. Sometimes. Mm-hmm. A condom on your finger, I suppose, too, eh? But, no, there are clerks, before you get your paper, who are looking at your finger, looking at your hand, and so on, deciding off stage, getting you out of paper. So anyway, it's 15%. I'm going on YouTube, you say, and saying that we have increased the percentage. Not at the lethal level, you're all still alive. But we increased the percentage to a point that it was irremovable.
So it's silver nitrate AgNO3, AgNO3, that compound.
AgNO3.
Yeah. Okay. Just for clarification, I thought it was a bit implausible, but just for anyone else that has the doubt that perhaps Vaseline could be used, I just wanted to double check so I'm conveying accurate information to people.
Before you came, I was telling that's exactly what we need. Mm-hmm. For foot soldiers. You don't belong to me, but I'm asking you to be a foot soldier. You are a friend of mine, so, and you explain these things out. And all those things we've been saying. But I think Chief wanted to say something about that particular impossible.
You know, you've dealt with Vaseline well, sir.
Yeah, it's really Vaseline for all of you. Frank, you have another question?
I have to say.
No. The issue on this concept, and you're right, it has to be a rumor that you can vote at more than one location. I don't know. The reality is, for you to vote at a polling station, you have to be listed to vote there. In that polling station, our presiding officer and the party agents will have a list that is specific to that polling station.
Mm-hmm. So, picture.
Mm-hmm. You've made the folio here. So, when you come into the polling station, my list says that there's Keith Lowenfield to vote. Keith Lowenfield is announced, the agents for their respective parties say, yeah, Keith Lowenfield, and they draw a line across Lowenfield's name, and then they go through the process and collect your ballot. And this time around, we show in the ballot to the agents that the stamp general and regional, and you go into your booth and you vote. Now, if you go to another polling station, then Keith Lowenfield would not be there.
List.
So you're not even having access to polling station 2 or 3 or you say many times. Mm-hmm. There is no accessibility because your name is not there. Even if you impersonate, you are Louisville, your vaccine has worked and you've removed the ink. When you go there, say you go there in another name, but you don't have an ID card, then the folio that the chairman has referenced comes into play where our staff, GCOMPO and APO, have all the folio for all the persons listed at that specific polling station. So you come, you somebody give you a name. You know Troy lives around the corner. Mm-hmm. So you come to say, I'm Troy Johnson. And you don't have an ID card. You have to pass through the process of probably having the features of Troy. And our presiding officer will be asking you, since you don't have an ID card, as the chairman mentioned earlier,
yeah.
What's your name? And your date of birth is? And your mother middle name is?
Okay.
So the questions we have for you, you were coming to impersonate some Troy. So I think we need to put to rest the concept that a man could leave polling station in Cummingsburg and go across to Alberta or Queenstown and hop around. It's just not possible.
Okay, thank you so much. And I hate to stress on the point, but I think suspicion, with the Youth Council have been trying to launch this Vote Like a Boss campaign. And part of that has been going around speaking to young people in the street and asking them, you know, are you voting this year? Is it your first time? Why don't you want to vote? Many people don't want to vote. And and also asking, what suspicions do you have? And I think there's a lot of suspicion that rigging will occur of some sort. So it's necessary to convey this information so people are in no doubt. So the other popular one that I've heard is that it's possible to... These are two that you could probably address in one breath. But A, it is possible if I have a brother, I'm Francis, and he may be Franco, right? And we look similar to each other, assuming the aforementioned Vaseline trick, which you just clarified, was able to work. Would there be any way for that person to impersonate? Is it possible to impersonate another person that you resemble? And the second being... that one person in some instance, I've heard this from a couple of people, that one person could be empowered to vote for up to 10, 15 people if they wanted, because their relatives or their friends overseas could empower them in some way to vote on their behalf. So mirror image thing, and then the 10 to 1.
10 to 1. Look. Listen to me. The empowerment being referenced, I'm assuming here, is the proxy.
Yeah.
The utilization of the proxy methodology. Well, I just want to inform those apparent impersonators that the procedure is very straightforward, and I can see that. You apply for a proxy. And you can start receiving your applications as at the 7th of April. And once the application to have a proxy, you and I have to live in the same division. We are on the same list.
But not in the same country necessarily.
You're in the same... Well, we have a listing system where for this polling station, it will be persons who reside, let's say, along district. So for you to have a proxy, we have to be on the same list. You and I am at that 12, you're at 40. Mm. So you apply and saying I'm bedridden, and there has to be a written application for a proxy. It has to be written stated.
So you can't just get a proxy?
No, just come into that. Okay. Let's see, you'll be done. It's just so you apply, you're saying I'm bedridden or whatever reason. When that application is made, our returning officers will be doing an investigation to find out whether the person you're applying to vote for they're indeed and in fact bedridden at lot 14 as mentioned. Now the returning officer will be utilizing for this investigation agents of political parties. So when you apply and you say, I live in lot 14, we're in the same division, and you expect to be approved, there will be, before approval or non-approval, an investigation, well, among here, GCOP, Party A, Party B, Party C. So all these procedures for 10 to 1 to work, I don't think in the combative mood of the parties at this point in time, they'll want to say, okay, it's my comrade, give me this one. It doesn't work that way. And you can ask those who are in the political arena if there's truly one vote for anybody else. So there'll be an investigation after the application that involves GCOM and all the agents from the respective parties will be going at lot 14 to see if this has happened.
But when you say lot 14, I'm sorry, in the sense this is very local.
Very local.
And
it's a local activity. Mm-hmm. If you're applying for someone else who is not here, then it will not be here. That's what I'm saying, sure.
Okay, because so if my family lives somewhere in Florida and they want me to vote on their behalf.
It's local, this is our elections.
I understand, but these are things right, doing the rounds that probably need to be clarified.
That's right.
And after the people who are looking alike and so on. You know, everywhere in the world you might do one fingerprint. Death. So when you go registering, you register the other boys that look just like you, you register too, but his fingerprints are there too. As a matter of fact, out of the 500,000 years created, we have not had that many duplicates. And when we do get them, we check them out immediately ourselves. But usually, it's a matter of the amount of points on the fingerprint that the people... If you're willing to pay more money, they'll put 60 points. They have told us, and the scientists have told us, you use 15 points for comparison. Every single fingerprint is compared with, let's say it's 500,000, with 499,990, everyone. So, if it's 15, they give you good results, and we live with that. That should probably be poor, but whatever. It will show up immediately, and if it doesn't, there are ways we will catch them.
Okay, and my final question on this topic would be: is there any part of the system that's going to be in effect that is electronic? Insofar as... Okay. Okay.
And if you come late, you can't get to that answer.
All right. Thank you very much. There you go, Michael.